Are we waiting for somebody or we will start?
So just give me a minute, sir. I'm starting to share my screen. We'll have your introduction and we can start it up, sir.
Sure. No problem. Should I stop my sharing?
Yes, sir. I have... No, sir. They are joining, sir. Yes, sir. We'll start.
So just give me a minute, sir. Starting to share my screen. We'll have your introduction and we can start it up, sir.
Sure.
Can you see my screen, sir?
Yes, I can see it. Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
Little bit delay is going on. Yes, I can see it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I think it is resound that is going on again and again.
Yes, I can see it.
Yes, sir. I, Dr. Nagashri from Aditya Bangalore Institute of Pharmacy Education and Research. We heartily welcome you all, respected speaker, Dr. Yes, Siddharth Hazari, sir.
I think it is resound that is going on again and again.
Sir, I think it is.
I, Dr. Nagashri from Aditya Bangalore Institute.
It is repeating.
Research.
Okay. So we shall continue, sir. I think if I give it a break, it is coming again and again. So I'll start it up, sir. So I, Dr. K. Nagashri from Aditya Bangalore Institute of Pharmacy Education and Research. We heartily welcome you, our respected speaker, Dr. Siddharth Hazari, sir. All the participants, teachers, students, and all other participants. Okay, I think I have this YouTube running live, sir. That's why I think. Just give me a minute, sir. I'll pause it up there so that I'll not get the sound. Okay, so now we'll not have the disturbance, and sorry for that.
That's better.
Yeah, because background YouTube was running, sir. I have shared it in the chat box, YouTube live. So for that, I couldn't see actually.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so can you see my screen, sir?
Yes, I can see it.
Your biodata I'm showing, it is clear, right?
Right.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for helping me in that. Sorry, participants, we have kept a little waiting for you guys as we are going live on stream. So it took me a few minutes delay in starting the program. So here we start the program for today. I, Dr. K. Nagashri from Aditya Bangalore Institute of Pharmacy Education and Research. We heartily welcome our respected speaker of the day, Dr. Siddharth Hazari, sir, and my dear all teachers, students, and all other pharma professionals. I take immense pleasure in welcoming you all for this session for the today. And we'll have a brief introduction about sir before starting the session. So here we have this session is in collaboration with IPA and HacksVO Life. So sir, we have a brief introduction. I tried my level best to cut short in it. So, but it was a very huge achievement sir has got. So I tried my level best to cut it short. So I hope it will not be a lengthy and I'll not consume the session sir. Because after looking into your bio data, I felt it so that I need a whole session to explain to our participants your achievements and all. So I started here. So Dr. Siddharth Hazari, CDM and PhD, currently is from the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Medicine, UC Davis Health System, and sir is holding US citizenship. Sir is microbiologist with extensive expertise in public health, microbiology, and cancer research with progressive experience in development, post-pathological interaction, assay development and validation, targeted cancer genomics, therapeutics, inflammation and bioinformatics analysis, leveraging knowledge of cutting-edge technologies, managing all aspects of laboratory setup and protocol development, and effectively collaborating with multidisciplinary teams. Over 10 years of experience and proficiency in diagnostic testing in microbiology area, nanoparticle medicated drug delivery and genomic technologies, biomarker assay development using traditional and modern molecular techniques in research and clinical microbiology setting. Sir has expertise in animal models and transitional applications. He has successfully wrote and served as a PI and a co-investigator in multiple NIH and NCI grants. Independent and goal-oriented leader with management and training experience, sir has strong technical background and excellent problem-solving and communication skills and working knowledge of laboratory compliance and safety rules. Seeking opportunities to apply his knowledge of infectious disease, molecular virology, immunology, and cancer. Technical expertise and interpersonal skills to lead a R&D laboratory and research team. Sir was nominated and selected to the AAAS Science Excellence in Science Program 2012. Sir's core competencies include 10 years of postdoctoral project scientist experience with a strong background in microbiology and molecular virology, public health microbiology certification in 2017, assay development validation and troubleshooting, real-time PCR, microarray and next-generation sequencing, technical knowledge of clinical microbiology testing, procedures, pre-analytical process, policies, procedures as necessary for the supervision of laboratory. And sir is having knowledge of safety policies and procedures, occupational hazards and safety precautions, including department and UCDHS infection control policies and procedures, including standard precaution procedures. Sir has bacteriological, parasitological, immunological, serological, virological, and other microbiological techniques. He has the expertise and over 5 years of in vitro diagnosis experience. He has been into the development of assay systems and protocols in FDA regulatory company and presentations of scientific data. And he has also conducted failure investigations, experience in working with cross-functional teams, ability to function and work effectively in a diverse work environment. Sir has laboratory operations management skill also, and excellent leadership skills and experience working with teams of diverse cultural background. Sir has mentored many graduate students earlier in his career as and also the scientists and the clinical fellows. So sir's professional experience includes working in the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Medicine, UC Davis Health System, CA. Then it is his current designation is working as assistant research professor and project scientist. And his key accomplishments include, he was a principal investigator for 2 SBIR grants and 2 other projects which have led to publications and several collaborations. Sir has worked in the Department of Pharmacology, Toxicology and Therapeutics in the University of Kansas Medical Center, Kansas City. He worked as Senior Scientist and Scientific Manager until 2012. And sir was working as Research Associate Scientist in the Department of Pathology and Lab Medicine, Tulane University School of Medicine, New Orleans, Los Angeles. And then sir was working as Postdoctoral Researcher in Department of Pathology and Lab Medicine, Tulane University School of Medicine, New Orleans, till 2008. And sir's education accomplishments include, sir has done his PhD in molecular virology and immunology from All India Institute of Medical Institute, New Delhi, India. He has completed it in 2004. Then sir has his master's in veterinary bacteriology and virology. He has taken the degree in 1998 from Orissa University of Agriculture and Technology, Bhubaneswar, Orissa, India. And bachelor's degree in veterinary science and husbandry in 1995, which is from Orissa University of Agriculture and Technology, Bhubaneswar, Orissa, India. It is equivalent to DVM in USA. And sir has licensings and patents to his name. So public health microbiology certification license, he has it in 2017. And a patent on delivery of siRNA virus nanosomes to inhibit hepatitis C virus replication in 2011. So sir was invited for long talks all over the globe, and his additional accomplishments include academic council member for the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Medicine, Davis, and that is his present from 2012 till present he is there, and graduate program.
Can't hear you. Hello? Can't hear you. I think it stopped. Can you hear me?
Okay. Yes, sir. Now can you hear, sir?
Yes, I can hear you.
Sorry. I'm extremely sorry for that. There was some power fluctuation over here. I'm sorry, participants, for that, and sorry, speaker, sir. And so here we go again. So sir has is journal reviewer and editor for more than 7 journals. And then sir has awards and grants to his name. Sir has 3 ongoing research supports. And sir has completed, I think it started again. Okay. So 3 completed research supports. And sir, to his name, he has 30 publications and book chapters. And then he has 10 posters and oral presentations, considering only the top tier. So I think, I have cut it short along, but still sir's accomplishments were too many that, you know, I couldn't fit it into one page. We think that all the participants, teachers and the students, we take you as inspiration to achieve our bio data into such an extent, sir. Thank you so much for accepting our seminar. I hand over the session to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Suchitra. Nice job.
Nagashri sir, sorry.
Nagashri, okay.
I'm stopping the share, sir.
I can use mine.
Yes, sir.
Can you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is clear, sir.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much for a nice introduction, and thank you all participants for this webinar, and thank you Mr. Shankar from HexBio who contacted me for this seminar. So this is a very good opportunity for me to share my experience and expertise, whatever I have during all this pandemic situation, I can share with you. So this is an emerging topic. This pandemic is continuing. We are still living with it. This is a very good example of, in my lifetime, I experienced this pandemic and how the pandemic outbreak occurs and what's the effect of it on the people's life. Everybody is affected everywhere, every corner of the world. A lot of people are affected. That's a learning experience for everybody and myself also. This will be kind of an informal session. So if anybody has question, we can answer it. If you can unmute yourself and or raise your hand. I cannot see actually when I am projecting my PPT full screen. But if you either write it in the chat session, we can answer it at the end. Right? That will be great. And then, so let me start. I think this is a very good platform for the pharma industry and other pharmaceutical institutes and universities. People are working very hard everywhere, every corner of the world. So this is an eye-opening session, how things will be shared amongst institutes and expertise to face this challenge. So my slides will be definitely on this line, but I'm a virologist by background, by training. I'm a virologist and worked with a lot of viruses during my career, still working on this. Currently, actually, my position is a senior microbiologist in California Department of Public Health. I'm still in touch with my research institute, UC Davis. If you want to add that to your information, let's start. Let's see. Okay, so this seminar or webinar, I will cover mostly four parts. I divided in my talk. First part will be introduction. I'll talk about a little bit virus genome and immunity, how this virus is, how the genome looks like and what are the proteins on the surface and inside, and what will be the immunity. And then second chapter, I'll talk about different types of vaccine, how the vaccines are prepared or what is the approach towards the vaccine. And then vaccine development for the COVID-19, where we are now. And challenges, Mr. Shankar was mentioning about what are the challenges faced by the pharmaceutical companies in preparing this vaccine and testing, and how we can overcome this challenge and make this vaccine available for the whole world, right? That's our goal. So this is the slide I got from a paper. I was reading in early January, I think, January, that time it came out. So it was showing how this coronavirus, there's the transmission occurs. There are different types of coronaviruses. I'll show you in my next slide exactly what is the differences between these coronaviruses. There are nine types of coronaviruses. in the family. And they are alpha, beta coronaviruses, gamma, delta, and then so forth. But the mostly the coronaviruses which are we are interested are beta coronaviruses, because the SARS coronavirus and other MERS and SARS coronavirus are, belongs to this beta coronavirus. And this graphical image showing mostly the viruses coming from either bats or different type of birds, right? The bats are a reservoir of many viruses. As I am a virologist, I know we also test rabies in our lab. So rabies is a virus we found mostly in bats. And bat population has to be controlled. And then in this country like US, controlled rabies long before. But countries like India and some other other developing countries, they have still not controlled rabies virus until till date. And there is some progress going on definitely in that direction. But being said that, bats are really a reservoir of a lot of viruses. Somebody told in a paper that bats can sometime point, one bat can carry like, they are carriers of viruses. They carry like 20, 30 viruses. And they live in a colony. As you see, there's a flock of bats will be there in a cave or in an old building or somewhere. And they carry these viruses. Bats do not, mostly not affected by these viruses. So it's very interesting. Their immune system is maybe better. Somehow they don't get infected. They carry these viruses. And then because of this close proximity and close closely living condition, they live in flocks in a group. They, bat viruses mutate very fast because they transmit from one bat to another and then they mutate. And these are RNA viruses, so they mutate very fast. So as you remember, I had remembered this intraspecies transmission occurs. So the bat maybe come in contact with other farm animals or like domestic animals like camel here or pigs or other. Other species, a cow, through another intermediate host, like rat, bird. So this intermediate host then come in contact with the other animals. And then from these animals, because the farm animals or the domestic animals or the wild animals, if the people are in touch or in contact with, you know, this contact has to be happen somehow. And then if they are in close proximity, then the virus adapted to the humans. They never come directly from bats to human. It might, but mostly through the another intermediate host needed to adapt. So the virus adapt first one species to another, and then they mutate, and then trying to find out another host. Always they look for virus is an intracellular parasite. It needs a host to replicate its own form. And that's why they need a definitive host. And then humans, when they are affected, they never saw this one virus. It's new to the human immune system or human body. So then they got sick, get sick, and then you have to develop more antibiotics or antivirals, and then you need a vaccine. All these things happen later. But the people got infected through the intermediate host. So this new coronavirus strain, COVID-2, SARS-CoV-2, mutated somehow and was, anybody was?
Okay. As,
hello? Should I go ahead? Okay. Yeah, let me continue. The transmission happens like this way. Okay, next. So as I was mentioning, the coronavirus classification, so this family of coronaviridae family, they have orthocoronavirinae genus. And then they have a lot of species. They have gamma coronavirus, delta coronavirus, beta coronavirus, alpha coronavirus. And the beta coronavirus, as I was mentioning, contains most of the recent infections of humans, like SARS coronavirus, MERS coronavirus, and then this new one is SARS coronavirus 2. And then The other important one is gamma coronavirus, which affects mostly the whales and dolphins and like those type of sea animals. And then some bat coronavirus belongs to alpha coronavirus. And they are very, not too much in the genotype origin, they're not too much difference yet. They are very close, but they mutate. And then they became adapted to another genome, and then they adapted to the population. Let me show you the other slide, next slide. Here I have shown the coronavirus genome. So this is a phylogenetic tree of coronaviruses, right? A phylogenetic tree describes how far this coronavirus family are distant from each other and amongst the genome at the species. And in this one, in the pink color, like the brown color, is the beta coronavirus. And they are here, as I was mentioning, there is two polyproteins, which are open reading frame. So as a virologist, I know these polyproteins, they code for different proteins. So there are several proteins in this virus, in this virus genome, like 16 non-structural proteins and 4 structural proteins, like the spike proteins, envelope protein, and nucleocapsid proteins, matrix proteins. So those are coded. Once these polyproteins are synthesized inside the body, and then inside the cell at least, and then these polyproteins will be clipped, and then each protein will be synthesized, taking mostly to hijack, the virus hijacks the host cell machinery to make these proteins. And then the virus will be evolved from the cell and infect new cells. We'll not go too detail on this, but remember, these are the surface proteins which are very immunogenic, and there is also this MERS coronavirus and SARS coronavirus. Amongst them, the genome is different, but not too much. They have similarity and identity. Okay, this is another way of depicting the same type of tree, phylogenetic tree. Here, we are showing the SARS-like viruses, SARS coronavirus, MERS. Why we are talking about SARS coronavirus and MERS coronavirus now with this SARS coronavirus too? Because it derived from that type of viruses. And that virus, those SARS and MERS, human people already saw that. Human people already infected with that. But that was not too much transmission-wise. It was controlled. And not a lot of death was not happening. It was not that much pandemic like this one. This is something different, definitely. And that's why it is more, transmission-wise, it is infecting more humans, and that's why rapidly growing. So the genome changed a little bit. That's why, and here I'm showing here the 3 coronavirus, SARS coronavirus, MERS coronavirus, and SARS coronavirus 2, their genome. If you see, there are, you cannot imagine, maybe not different too much, but there is some difference because their genome size is a little bit different. Like 30 kb, here it is 27.9 kilobase, and it's around 30 kb. So there is some different, and that because of that difference, it is different. It has to be treated as a different virus. And this coronavirus, mostly around 100 to 160 nanometer size and diameter. And you can see it by using electron microscope, right? And it's a positive sense RNA, you know. And it has got, as I described, ORF open reading frames, and then 1A, 1B codes for polyproteins. And the surface proteins are spike proteins. And these are very important in terms of preparing vaccines and antibody response. So all these immunogenic reactions happen on the surface protein, spike protein. And that's why the tests are also developed basing on this surface protein. I will not go detail onto the test. That's another topic right now. Okay. We will talk about a little bit about pathogenesis, how this virus infects the human organ, right? mostly virus upper respiratory tract, like the through the nasal passage, nasal or oropharynx, oral passage, it go and mostly go and damage the lungs. How it does that? Okay, let me see, somebody raised their hand. Yeah, please unmute yourself and ask a question.
So we'll have the question session in the last. For that, they are raising their hands, sir.
Okay, okay. That's fine. Okay, then. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Am I clear till now?
Yes, sir, it is clear.
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay, thank you. So the COVID pathogenesis happens mostly on the upper respiratory tract, and it the virus travels to the lung epithelial cells and damage it. How it damages? So if you see on the left side of this picture, this is a diagnosis. I will talk about it a little bit later. Let's see first how the virus entry to the cells. The virus enters through the receptors. So every cell has some receptors on the surface. So, but not every cell will be infected by every virus. Why? Let me give an example. The hepatitis viruses only infects the liver cells. So liver cells have got receptors that can be only infected by the hepatitis viruses, like hepatitis A, hepatitis B virus, hepatitis C virus. So the other lung cells will be not affected because they don't have that type of receptor. So that's why whenever somebody asks me, if you inhale this virus, coronavirus, then you'll be infected. If you ingest, like if you eat this virus, maybe nothing will happen because the esophageal cells will not have the receptors present that the virus will be attached. So the receptor entry process is very important for a viral entry to the cell because it is a receptor mediated entry. And then once it is contact with the receptor, it's called ACE receptor, acetyl coenzyme E, which is showing here. The virus get entry into the cell and then start hijacking the cell machinery to to synthesize its RNA, to synthesize its proteins, everything. And then the virus particle will be coming out. By doing that, when they come out, the immune system recognizes this, our host immune system. And host immune system major players are macrophages, which are antigen presenting cells. So whenever they see an antigen, like here in this case, it's a virus, then they will produce, the dendritic cells will be activated, the epithelial cells on the surface will be activated, and then the antigen presenting cells, which is coming from the macrophage, it's a kind of T cell, it will produce cytokines. And these cytokines, a lot of cytokine storm happens. In this case, a lot of people are infected and got hospitalized because of this cytokine storm is so large, because virus replicates so efficiently and so rapidly, the cytokine body immune system thinks that it is all happening very quick. And then there is a lot of cytokine surge happens. And that also is a bad effect on the other organs of the body. So the other organ failure happens because of this cytokine storm. A lot of interleukins and cytokines are released from these cells. And then that will also have a bad effect. Those are better for the virus to control virus, but this virus also hijack those cytokine presenting cells and make it think that it's a normal cell, and the virus attacks those also. So it's kind of it's a win-win situation for a virus. And then the CD4 cells come into play, the CD4 T cells, which are, you know, those cytokine producing cells, other T cells also activated because of this antigen presenting cells. And then once these CD4 T cells are activated, the plasma cells, as you know, maybe from your immunology lecture, the B cells in our body, they produce antibodies to fight the virus or any antigen, the plasma cells, B cells produce with the help of TH2 cells, T helper 2 cells, these they produce the antibodies. The antibodies go and bind to the virus and then neutralize it. That's the fundamental process of immunology. But this during this process, the virus is so active and killing all the epithelial cells of the lungs, that damages the whole lung and pleura, and a lot of pleural fluid accumulates. That's why pneumonia occurs, and then the disease is called acute respiratory syndrome. That's why called SARS is called nothing but severe acute respiratory syndrome, right? So that happens. This is a sort form of describing what happens in the immunological wise. And there is some diagnosis test developed in the lab during this pandemic, and mostly the genomic amplification using the RT-qPCR, quantitative PCR, which is called real-time quantitative PCR, detecting the genome. We have several types in our lab. We are testing right now. We are using a multiplex system which can detect three proteins of the virus at a time. Within 1 hour, we can detect all this with a 96 well plate format. So the first of all, in January or February, a lot of problem occurred. The assay developed, and then we can now in a better situation in diagnosing this virus. Better way, every country is doing this. And then there is a high throughput sequencing platform available. Some clinical lab or big hospital lab, they use this to rapid testing of a lot of samples. And then ELISA, ELISA tests are developed to detect antigen or antibody. But still this, I will say, we are still debating on using this antibody test because the immunity of this virus, how long this immunity, how long this antibody IgG and IgM response is there, we don't know yet, real, till maybe 2 months or 3 months. We don't exactly know. And these antibody tests are a little bit sometimes giving false positive. So they're tweaking it, and it will coming very soon. And there are some lateral flow tests like these rapid tests, which are became popular very early, but they had some problem also because this sensitivity issue. And they cannot detect less than some particles. So if it is a false negative, then it's a problem. The people can be negative, but it will carry the virus, and then it can infect other people. So that's a problem. So still a lot of effort is going on in this direction. Okay, next. Here I am showing this. Why I am showing this? This why? How this acute respiratory distress syndrome happens? As I was mentioning, there are these ACE2 receptors are there, and then virus enters through the cell, and then cytokines are produced. We can block this process. There is some drugs available, as you might have also listened in the news or read from the different articles. There are some companies made already the antiviral drugs for other viruses, or they modified this the drugs they have, antiviral drugs, and tried to inhibit. What they had in the self, there are some JAK inhibitors. JAK kinase, JAK kinase. This virus in the T cell block, they can block this T cell response so that the antigen presenting cell can be blocked. And then the JAK inhibitors can act on this type of mechanism, cytokine storm can be stopped. So the JAK inhibitors were used before for other viral diseases. So that was available so that people can, you know, take in a ill patients like who are in hospitalized and need help, they can be used to these drugs. So there is some help, and there is some new drugs also people companies are making to target this virus so we can have a better effect. These are some, you know, different approach people are taking and companies are taking to make newer drugs. Okay, then comes to the vaccine, and definitely everybody is talking about vaccine because this lockdown thing is happening. Every country is having problem in checking this lockdown, and there's a lot of effort, you know, to the epidemiologist and public health authorities. They have to track down people who are infected and making them quarantine. All this effort is a lot of effort and a lot of time taking process and locking down also affecting a lot of economy in these countries. So how to prevent this? Prevention is better than cure, always. So there are a lot of vaccine approach for every virus, viral diseases or bacterial diseases. Some of the bacterial diseases have got vaccine. So the thing is that usually a vaccine takes a lot of time to prepare. Here in this timeline, normally people take, like companies make vaccines, take around 10 years or more than 10 years. Preclinical testing, then clinical testing, then monitoring, a lot of efforts. Here, I was showing preclinical testing, you have to test in the animal models, like mouse, ferret, or monkey models. Then come up with the idea, okay, this is the leading compound, leading vaccine candidate, and then we go for clinical testing. Clinical testing, there are mostly three clinical phases are there, phase one, phase two, and phase three. And then phase one, dose is tested. So the vaccine, a lot of things taken into consideration. The vaccine should be work, whichever design should work for a huge population, right? Like a vaccine should work for a for children's, for adults, and for different demography of populations, for Asians, for Caucasians, for African Americans. So there are different type of immune response happens in our different, our bodies, human body is different. Everybody responds to the antigen differently. So the antigen presenting cell, which is a major histocompatibility, MHC1, MHC2, derived from those. So that taken into consideration in the beginning to design a vaccine, which peptide or a part of the virus will take, or the whole virus will take. I'll come to that, how the vaccine is designed. But these are the things taken during this preclinical testing. And then a small dose, how much dose we need to be given, or a multiple dose has to be given, which interval we need to give, how many days interval. Because some of the vaccine, you know, hepatitis B vaccine, you have to take 3 doses. So we have to take a booster dose at some point to boost the immune system. So all this has to be decided at this type of clinical trials. And then it may take a lot of time. I'll come to that. Why it is taking a lot of time? A lot of volunteers needed. Around 40 volunteers needed for each candidate vaccine. So the volunteers has to be agreed, because they don't know what will happen. It's a risky thing. So that's why volunteer were given some kind of, you know, either a monetary benefit or something. They have to agree that the vaccine trial has to be done. And then the phase two trial is a large number of population has to be, has to be taken into consideration. And they have to be studied, because they have to be injected the vaccine, and then they have to be either live or inactivated virus has to be injected. Either they are neutralizing the virus or they are becoming sick. They have to be studied. Sometimes the antibodies taken from these persons are cultured within the lab to neutralization effect, to see the neutralization effect, how much virus particle they are neutralizing, or how long they can neutralize. So all this happens during this phase clinical trials, and it takes a lot of time normally. And then the final phase is mass vaccination has to be occurred throughout the world, because this SARS coronavirus can travel from one country to another. That's why it started in the beginning. So we have to make sure that the vaccine which will be given to a population has to be given throughout the world kind of same time, or you have to restrict people's travels. Nowadays, to restrict people travel is very difficult, because everywhere people can go within 24 hours reach. So the idea people took to design this vaccine, and everybody's effort is very, very rapidly how we can design this. So they squeeze this 10 years, 13 years time into 12 months to 18 months maximum, they have time. And then a lot of government pressure is there. Vaccine is needed. So, but the companies are under pressure, a lot of pressure to design, to formulate, and somehow they have to consolidate these steps to 6 to 9 months. See, this is the challenge we have. This is the real challenge pharmaceutical companies have to take care of how to prepare this vaccine safely, effectively, within a short period of time, right? let's see what happens. Okay. The vaccine, a little bit the basics about vaccine, different types of approach. What are the different types of approach we can take? So there are different types of viral vaccines can be prepared. One is a viral vector, which is another virus. I will come to that. Another virus can carry this coronavirus genome, and then these virus proteins can be, you know, they can be immunogenic. So they can produce antibodies. But another approach is that inactivated virus. You inactivate some of the proteins so that it cannot enter into the it can just attach, do not repeat. So that is called inactive. Part of the protein, not the whole part, immunogenic. That has to be carried out, some research has to be done. And then they know, okay, this peptide, if I give a part of the protein, what is mute? Anyway, then they have to be immunogenic, and then antibody will be produced. And then virus-like particles, and then DNA. Only the RNA or DNA we can take and make it attenuated virus, and then give it to the human so that they can produce. So these are the different types of approach we can take. How this vaccine gives immunity? So once the virus enters, the spike protein and M protein and the RNA all may be playing a role to giving a immunity, right? The virus enters, as I told you before, the virus has a vesicle, it releases the DNA, RNA, viral RNA transcribed into proteins, and then assembly occurs. Then the virus release. The immune response, the T helper cells, the antigen presenting cells, I'm giving again this thing to see, so how this process, exactly this type of process we need to fit into the viral vaccine approach. So in the vaccine approach, we don't need to give a live virus. We can give a different type of particle in a different way so that this whole immune system can recognize that, so that they produce the antibody response or whatever the antigen presenting cell has to recognize. So all these things happening in the cytosol has to be happen with this type of approach, right? So they know that now spike protein is a very good protein that can be can develop immunogenicity. Okay, next. Then the vaccine approach, we have this, as I told you last slide, spike protein, they caught a part of the spike protein or a part of the genome which codes for the spike protein, right? That recombinant, then they will put into another vector called recombinant vector. So this is a recombinant DNA technology. So then that this virus can carry this part and then spike, that can code for the spike protein, right? These can then given to the cell to produce antibody. Cells infected by this vaccine produce spike proteins as if they were infected by coronavirus. So this is a very good approach that the cells can recognize the spike proteins, and then spike proteins, if they're on the surface of a cell, infected cell, the antibodies can be produced by the same mechanism, the cell mechanism. The subunit vaccine, which is a mass produce of spike proteins. So the pharmaceutical company or the vaccine company, they produce this subunit vaccine by just producing the spike proteins in a formulation. And then that give them. And then the spike protein can go and attach. In this case, it is a viral vector carrying the spike protein. In this case, directly the spike protein. So this may be a little bit challenging in the sense that they have to be, you know, conciled in some way. They cannot be destroyed by the pH of the body, or they have to be reached to the cells, where it has to be given, intramuscular or intranasal spray. All this has to be, you know, taken care into consideration at the time of subunit vaccine. Then there is a nucleic acid vaccine. So as I was mentioning, the part of the nucleus, like genome, then that copies has to be produced. It's called RNA vaccine. Like this is the RNA virus. So the lot of small copies of this RNA has to be produced, then they can be injected by gene therapy approach, and then the cells can be infected, and then the virus the antibodies can recognize. So these are the different approach different companies are taking. Okay, let's see next. Okay, so as I was mentioning, now I was got this one information just before 2 hours. There are about more than actually 140 coronavirus vaccines prepared by are in different phases by different companies. So as you see here, out of this 440 till now, phase one clinical trial, which is a very small trial, 14 companies are already started for the safety and dose, like how much dose we have to give and if it is safe or not. Phase two, there are 10 already. They have expanded this from the phase one to phase two for the safety trial. And then phase three, there are large scale clinical trials going on. It's still going on. It will take some time because this has to be completed in a certain time period. They have to see the immunogenicity, how long the immune response is there, how long the antibodies can be there in the body if a vaccine is given, so that the virus challenge can be neutralized by the vaccine. And there is only one approval approved. I think it is from the Oxford Biologicals. They are trying, in the critically ill patients and some other healthcare worker, frontline workers, and they are giving them. So the approval process for one only approved now. Okay, next. Okay, so same thing, but I will go a little bit deeper into this different type of viral vaccine approach. Here, mostly, we have DNA or RNA vaccines, okay? We have live attenuated vaccine. Live attenuated means this virus is attenuated. It will not infect, but it will act as a, it is all the proteins will be expressed and some of the part of the genome is taken out, so the virus will be not replicating. And there is inactivated, the genome is inactivated by some way, but the particles will be, viral particle will be there. And then subunit vaccine. And then viral vector carrying the genome, SARS coronavirus genome. How it works? So this DNA or RNA vaccine uses DNA or RNA molecules to teach the immune system to target key viral protein. Okay, advantage for this is easy and quick to design because we already have a synthesizer or we can synthesize in the huge labs they have in the pharmaceutical companies and they can prepare this RNA or DNA in a lot of copies and easy to quickly design. Disadvantage never been done before for this virus. There are no licensed DNA or RNA vaccines currently in use for any virus particular. So they are taking this approach, as I showed before, because to target the populations, to prepare the viral vaccines in a short time, they have to design some other way. So this is a way to design very easy and quick, so and produce also. So we don't have much knowledge on this type of viral vaccines, but this is a very good approach also. And the group of testing is done by Modern RNA, which is a company in the US. They are very actively, they are in phase one, I think phase one clinical trial done. And then another company, Inovio, so they are putting a DNA vaccine. So this is the DNA RNA vaccine front going on. And there is a live attenuated. This is a weakened version of the actual virus, as I was describing. And that stimulates a robust immune system without causing any serious disease. That's good, good for the vaccine. May not be safe for those with compromised immune system. What happens? Because we have some people immunocompromised, like cancer patients who are under treatment or some other immunocompromised patients. So we cannot give this vaccine because they may react differently and then they may suffer, that may damage to the other organs. But we have measles and mumps and rubella and chickenpox are done, vaccines are done basing on this approach. And it is very well known, these vaccines every day, people are taking, children are taking, everybody, safety-wise, it is very good. and Indian Immunologicals, and I think other companies are also preparing this vaccine. Then comes the inactivated vaccine, which uses the whole virus after it has been killed with heat or chemical reaction. So they inactivate the genome, but the protein part is intact. It is safe because the virus is already dead, but easy to make also. Sorry. Disadvantage is not as effective as a live virus. Some previous inactivated vaccines have been made, disease the host. Safety-wise, this is a little bit problematic. So you have to have a lot of safety issues which has to be taken into consideration. Polio vaccine is one of the inactivated vaccine, but polio vaccine was a DNA virus, so it was easy to, you know, and it is a oral vaccine. So it was very, very good in that sense. And a lot of people got, you know, this vaccine, polio virus is kind of eradicated, except some part of the, some countries, small countries have got still going on. But, you know, India did a very good job in eradicating polio virus by vaccinating. And Sinovac, Sinopharm, all these pharmaceutical companies are doing this coronavirus vaccine on the same line. Then subunit vaccine. This focuses on the immune response of the most important part of the virus. So then they may not stimulate a strong response as these chemicals need to be added to boost long-term immunity. So there is some things to be added. As you were telling, the subunit particle has to be combined with some things to give the boost to the immune system. And there are some hepatitis B and human papilloma virus vaccines are already available. So we know this vaccine works. Novavax and other companies are making it. There is a viral vector. Ebola virus, when it started recently, last year, Ebola virus vaccine was developed using this vector. So this approach takes a harmless virus, such as adenovirus, which may not cause any problem or any disease in our body, but it can carry this part of the genome, viral genome, to build this immunity. So live viruses tend to elicit stronger immune response. Because it's a viral vector and it's a live virus and it will not affect the humans, but it can, you know, carry the gene inside for the coronavirus, and then we have to we'll have a better immune response. And important to put in, but the disadvantage in this system is we have to select a good viral vector, which may not cause any problem, for the vaccine approach. And then all the most, lot of animal vaccines are based on this, and Ebola virus vaccine one. And the Oxford University and AstraZeneca, Sanra, and whatever, the Johnson & Johnson, they are making this type of vaccine. So overall, there are a lot of different approaches happening, but as you see, there are a lot of advantages and disadvantages of this vaccine approach, and we have to take into consideration, the companies are taking into consideration of all these things when they are designing this vaccine. And then they have to come up with clinical trials that has to be passed by the different agencies. And then they have to be safety-wise and everything has to be passed. Then they will produce mass production has to be there. And then that has to be distributed properly to different parts of the world. And then, it's a long process. So that's why vaccine takes time. People are asking why the vaccine is not ready yet. It takes time. But believe me, scientists are working day and night to prepare this whole thing in from 10 years to within 1 year. They are trying to do it. Okay, so currently, what is the timeline we have? 2020, a lot of research happened. Same time, mostly people didn't do much research because they knew that a lot of research was before done on coronaviruses, like SARS coronavirus studied well, MERS coronavirus studied well. A lot of things are already there in the pipeline. So they have to tweak it. Some things they have to tweak it and come quickly about this finding things and this type of this new strain. And clinical trials are happening. Same time, manufacturing is also happening, right? So this part, manufacturing part, actually happens late. After this clinical trial finished, then the companies will produce manufacturing. But as you see here, they are building factories now to make mass production because they know that around 6 billion people have need vaccine in all over the world. And the multiple doses has to be prepared and the vials has to be synthesized. Everything has to be coordinated. So they already started, some companies already started preparing this on these lines. So these things are simultaneously growing. As these clinical trials are progressing, we are in this phase now, somewhere in between. But the manufacturing process is progressing also at the same time. And that's why they produce quickly. And then approval process is also very, you know, FDA here in this, in the US, the FDA, Food and Drug Administration. And in India, I think ICMR is taking help of WHO. With the help of WHO, every country has got their own agencies to approve things. Then they are also in their, formulation, how to make approval process very quick. So all these things are happening very coordinated way. And it has to be happened like this. Otherwise, we cannot have a vaccine in early 2021. We may not, maybe thinking, people are thinking some vaccines will be available by end of this year or early next year. But it will take some, definitely 2021 vaccines will be there as they are projecting. Okay, what is the status of vaccine preparation by different countries, different areas? So this one I got recently from a paper. There are different projects going on. Mostly North America is in leading, confirmed. There are a lot of confirmed virus, unconfirmed. So the non-profit organizations, very less public foundations, mostly private and industries, as you see, it's the pink. Pink depicts the private and industry. They are taking the lead in most of the countries. And China also, a lot of effort is going on. In other parts of the world, Europe has a lot of candidates coming up. And Asia also, like India, might be also partnering with, I think, Oxford Biologicals to make Sanofi and AstraZeneca. They're making mass production. They're trying to make mass production of vaccine in India. So everybody is, every part of the world is trying to do certain things, and whichever comes first, they will try, So that's why a lot of efforts is going on, and mostly leading is private industry, private foundations or industries are doing a good job. And academic also giving some efforts, but not much that compared to here. So the vaccine mostly is controlled by, taken care of by private and industries, pharmaceutical and biotech industry. Okay, so what is the challenge? So I found a very interesting thing. Let me talk to you people, like three challenges we have. One is safety and efficacy, okay? We don't know, we just discussed like how safe is the vaccine. We are preparing in a short time. People are will be thinking, oh, this vaccine is safe or not, or how efficiency it has, because the virus may be mutating or new viral strains can, new coronavirus can attack. All this are in mind. So that is a challenge for the companies. And then there is a distribution and storage of large amount of doses. This we don't see in day-to-day life. When we are taking vaccine, we go to hospital or a pharmacy or some clinic and we get the vaccine. But behind the scene, a lot of effort is there how to store this large amount of doses in a proper temperature, proper environment, and proper vial, so the vaccine can be stable for a long time. And distribution means, this virus is spreading from one place to another. So we have to give in doses to everybody at the same time, In India, like Tamil Nadu or Maharashtra and Karnataka, if they are close, they have to be given vaccine in those hotspots very, every time, everything you'll be having same time. Vaccination has to be occur same time. So this is that process has to be there. And then comes herd immunity. I didn't talk about herd immunity. I could have given a slide, but let me tell you, herd immunity is nothing but like a community. In a community, how many people are having immune to the virus? if 90%, 80 to 90% people are infected and clear the virus, like in India, a lot of people are clearing the virus. And in also different parts of the world, they're clearing the virus. They're immune to the virus. Their antibodies are already developed. But being said that, antibody response, they just now found out it's not enough, like 2 to 3 months. But still, you know, the virus, next time they will not get it immediately. So that's called herd immunity. The virus will die out if a lot of people in a community have got immunity. Okay? So that herd immunity comes if more than 90%, 80% people will be vaccinated. So that has to be also taken care of. These are the challenges for the vaccine. And there is another thing going on, mostly in this part of the world where I am now. This is a very dicey thing. There are some pro-vaxxers, like they don't want vaccine. They think that, government is something, some people think in their head that government is making something and giving us, we can clear the virus on our own. Some people also think that our own immune system can clear this virus. But vaccine is always a better thing. Always prevent diseases, as we know from history. We have saved human life from pandemic. Flu pandemic happened. Flu virus vaccine also, a lot of people are saved. A lot of diseases, vaccines are saving life. But people think that why people want to take a vaccine when there is a natural immunity occurs. But if you see this virus, if you are not taking vaccine and you are a silent, transmitter, which is, you know, you are spreading the virus. If you are not immune properly and you are still shedding the virus, you can infect others, like the elderly people or the very severely ill patients or immunocompromised patients. They may get the virus too. So, but this thing is changing. You see this data I got, pro-vaxxers were saying around 50% people were saying in January, oh, okay, we will take the vaccine, but there are some people who are telling, no, we will not take. But this percentage increased now to 65% during the February and March. So this may change. This thing may be changed. This is a challenge for some part of the world. People are not willing to take the vaccine. Okay, so let's, and this one is a challenge, money. Hey, money is a factor, so who is, if the vaccine paired, a lot of cost is there. How to bear this vaccine will be free for some people, or if you have insurance, you can, insurance company has to pay for this. All these things are there also. And I have shown this picture that this little guy sleeping in the night and thinking about, oh, coronavirus attacking me, give me vaccine so that I'll be immune. So this is just a thought. Okay. There are some other articles I read recently. So recently, like Wednesday, came the news that intentionally infecting people with coronavirus, a vaccine trial. You know, this they think that it's a challenge because there is ethical issues are there, how to deal with this issue, because it's a severe disease. People are really worried about and is afraid of this thing. So nobody will be volunteering. So how to make these people make this success? So there's FDA biological evaluation research, the recent guidelines requiring vaccine candidate must be at least 50% more effective than a placebo. So they cut down the effectiveness of a vaccine to 50%. Usually it is should be 90%, but the placebo versus other group, they have to cut down 50% to make it happen very quick. So every front, people are trying different approach. And then the pressure is on, as I was telling before, that different parts of world, president is telling, vaccine has to be there because people are dying or people need this to go out or, schools has to open. All these issues are there. So the governments, they want to open things very fast. So the companies are making things, you know, in a rapid way. And there are a lot of coordinated effort. As you see from my slides, it's happening. WHO is a World Health Organization. It's coordinating with all the parts, different parts of the world, how to prepare the vaccine. Different companies also participating amongst themselves, who will design what, who will prepare the vaccine, who will prepare the mass production of vaccine, who will prepare the first phase clinical trial. So all these different companies, different part of the world, they are teaming up. And this one I am showing just the Prime Minister Modi in India. He's a meeting with high level experts in India and other parts of the world, how to make vaccines in India, and India's future will be in good shape. So everybody, every part of the world, they're trying in different way to make it success within a short period of time. So that's the goal. And it is happening. And believe me, it will be happening very soon. In the sense, not soon means within a month, but it by end of this year or by early next year, things will be definitely going in right direction. And a lot of candidates, vaccine candidates are on the front line. So I think this is my last slide. And thank you. If you have any questions, anything we can discuss, I'll stop here for my talk.
So we have, that was very wonderful session, sir, very much needed session in this time. So we have few questions from the participants. I think they would love to listen to the answers.
Sure.
Yes, sir. Just a minute.
Let me see, chat.
Yes, sir. So one question, one participant, Jnana Chandran. So he is asking that TH1 and TH2 imbalance is the cause of COVID-19 virus causing pneumonia. Dear Siddhartha Hazari, please suggest a few basic antiviral drugs for SARS-CoV-2. How long it will take normally to launch vaccine for mass after all the trials? That was the question.
Okay, so the first, so there are two questions there. One is the about TH1 and TH2 response and how the how antiviral drugs will be acting on those. The second question will be, okay, let me talk to the first question, answer it. Good question, very good question. So the immunity in the body is causing a lot of problem. The virus is causing problem, means the immune response, as I told, the TH1 response, which will be helping in cytokine response to kill the virus. Most of the time, it happens in a well-formatted way, different type of bacterial or viral infections. But in this case, the virus is making so much tolls, cells. They are there is an immune surge, and this TH and TH1 balance is not there. So JAK inhibitors may work, but those are expensive drugs. So the antiviral drugs, which are directly acting antiviral drugs, like Glentech, company which is making Bruciclavir, those are okay. Those are okay drugs which are already trialed before for other antiviral viruses. They're good. Now, certain agencies or certain hospitals, they tried dexamethasone, which is a steroid, which can, if you can give in a low dose with other combination of other drugs, it can work. They saw that in a critical ill patients, in a highly inflammatory response, it can subside. So that's one of the approach we can take. And people are actually, physicians are taking that approach in some parts of the world. The second question is about Kindly remind me which what is the vaccine? Kindly
antiviral drugs for SARS-CoV-2. How long it will take normally to launch vaccine for mass after the trials?
Oh, okay. So as I was mentioning, so the things are happening very simultaneously. So the production and the companies are making things ready. As I was listening to the news recently, the Oxford Biologicals and Sanofi with Indian Biologicals and what's the company? Serum Institute, right? That's in Pune. So the Bharat Biologicals and Serum Institute, they are preparing mass vaccine vials and making things ready. So like with millions of doses, they want to make it very soon. So once the things will be approved, no time, like within a month, vaccine will be ready, million doses. So it will be very quick.
The next question from the same person, sir. What is the role of WHO in development of these vaccines?
Yes, as I just saw one slide about WHO's. WHO coordinating the efforts from different parts of the country, how they are doing the vaccine and where it will be distributed. After the vaccine is made, where it has to be deployed, okay? Countries which are affected most, it will go there first. Like suppose Europe, like UK, France, Italy, which need most, they will coordinate. Effort. So the WHO, when it is happened, yeah, so that's the mostly the WHO is doing the coordinating part and efficacy, how to distribute safely to the different parts of the world. So those type of things he's taking care of.
Yes, sir. Next question we have. In India, few companies about to launch vaccine in month of August this year. What will be the safety margin of these vaccines?
Yeah, I just read the news. I don't know exactly what will happen, but they are launching, I think, with the it's a phase one clinical trial kind of thing. Okay. I think it is, I'm not sure, but it will be open to the people who are in critically ill patients waiting for, otherwise waiting for treatment. Or very, highly immunocompromised patients, the vaccine can give in and then they can be, treated well, taken care of, well. Even the vaccine fails, okay, that's fine because they tried. So I don't know exactly what will happen in things safety-wise, I don't know. They must have, tested, but I am not sure about it.
Sir, another question we have from Mr. Abdul Rahman. Can you explain about RT-PCR and the plasma therapy process, sir?
Okay. Yeah, RT-PCR is a diagnostic test. It's a real-time PCR. 2-3 genes amplifying for the virus. So the viral particles will be collected in the sample tube, BTM media, and then comes to the lab. Then you have to extract the RNA from the virus. And then the probes and primers are designed to amplify a part of the genome, like spike protein part or nucleocapsid protein part or ORF1. Small probes are designed. And we are using here a multiplex assay system, which a single well, you can put the RNA and we can detect 3 genes at the same time. So it will be quick and also sensitive. So that's called RT-PCR. The other question, forgot. What was the other question?
Plasma therapy processes.
Oh, yeah. So plasma therapy is definitely a good idea because these people, whenever recover, their plasma can be, blood can be donated and plasma can be taken out because the plasma contains most of the antibody. And those antibodies can help a very critically ill patient if you give this plasma directly, this antibody will go and fight against the virus, and you know, virus replication goes down. So there is a lot of effort going on. Whoever recovering, they can voluntarily donate blood or plasma, and then that plasma can be used. But there is a certain time period. You cannot keep for a long time. But you know, people are already in the hospitals. They can be used. It's very easily used, and it's very effective. But it is not mass production, so it's very limited. You know, one person can give one time plasma, and then wait for another 3 months, and that time the immunity is not there. So you know, those type of issues are there. So yeah, it is effective immediately, but it is not a mass production type of thing. Like vaccine is a mass, we can give it to mass, a lot of people at the same time.
And we have one more question, sir. Very informative session. Can you please elaborate on herd immunity?
Herd immunity, yeah, I was telling that same thing. So herd immunity is the immunity in a community. Like, suppose, think about a city. Think about Bangalore. So Bangalore, there are different sectors, right? The sectors means those people like live in that sector. They don't travel too much, you know, or even travel very less. But amongst them, if 90% of the people are immune to the virus, then the virus will not go beyond that. They will virus transmit to one person to one person, but if it is immune, it will not go and infect. So the virus will die out, in the sense the virus will not find another host. Okay, another host to replicate. So it will die out. It's an intracellular virus. Virus is an intracellular event happens. So if it's not finding a live host, it will die out. It will not transmit. So think about it. If every sector of a city, 90% of people are in vaccinated or immune or recovered from the viral infection, they are immune. So those are called herd immunity. Once the herd immunity achieved, in our country, to achieve herd immunity is a huge thing, because we have 1.3 billion people, right? It will take a lot of time to do. But now the infection rate is high. Maybe in this rate, more people will be recovering, herd immunity will be happening. But with the vaccine, the herd immunity will happen more rapidly. So that is a good thing. So the virus will not, you know, transmit further.
So we have another question from Mr. Narasimha Murthy. What is the size of virus in terms of nanometers?
I was showing a slide on that, 100 to 160 nanometer size.
So, and one more question, I think we'll come to an end with this. It is from Mr. Harshit Reddy. So can we reduce the cause of COVID-19 by ourselves, by home remedies? Can you please tell what can be home remedies?
I am not an expert on the, you know, Ayurvedic medicine or home remedies. But being said that, I believe also, I usually take myself, you know, a lot of Indian herbs, you know, to make my immune system good. The first thing you have to do is you have to put mask. If you are going out to a public place, right? Nobody is telling you to stay home, but you know, some countries people don't take care, so they get out. But being said that, if you wash your hand properly, every time go out, come back, wash your hand. And if your immune system is good, but being said that, if your immune system is good also, you will be getting the virus, but you can clear the virus, right? So good exercise, good food, good herbal medicine, whatever you have, you can take. But this virus is a very, very new virus. It's a very, you know, everybody is finding new things about it every day. So researchers also find things. Some people told in February or March that summer comes, this virus will go away. No, it's not going away. It is still there, right? So things might not happen as you think. This virus is making us crazy. So please take precaution, and also get your immune system boost up, exercise, good food. That will help. But I don't think only taking medicines or herbal products will help?
I think you have answered for this question, sir, but I would like to repeat. It is from Ms. Priyanka Savant. Have plasma therapy work on COVID-19?
Yes, it worked. It worked, but as I told you before, the plasma is not available for everybody, right? Only people who voluntarily give blood donation, recovered, immediately they come and give. There is a, you know, different countries, people, government tell that, okay, whoever recovered, please come and give blood so that we can have plasma. It is clear, cure, but that should be enough antibody there. You know, if a person is already infected with a lot of virus, may not be. Already different organs are already affected. It may not be recovered. But in early stage, it can help.
Yes. Ms. Chaitanya Devlapalli, what is the one approved vaccine for COVID-19?
The mRNA type of vaccine, which is one of the companies, Modern RNA, is preparing. That's in the very last trial. So that's the best one candidate now. But others will come up. So subunit vaccines are also there in phase 3 clinical trial from Europe. So those are the two candidates that are coming up very early stage. Like, not early, means a very late stage.
So participants, they are requesting for your PPT, sir, with your permission, if you have.
Yes, I can post it as a PDF. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Can I send you any email or anything?
Yes, sir. For the requested participants, we will give them, sir, because they are telling us, you know, they wanted to really have your PPT information. That's right.
No problem.
We I'll have make your it... permission. We will collect it and we will forward, sir.
No problem. I will forward yeah. it to the email address, right? Yeah.
Mr. Harshit Reddy, everyone are telling that we can cure COVID-19 by ourselves by boosting our immune system by home remedies. Can we cure ourselves if it is more in critical condition?
I don't think so. You have to go hospital and put a ventilator. Because you need help. Home remedies will not...
Yes.
taking home remedies will overset. So if you know that you have temperature, you have body ache, and you have some type of symptoms, then go to hospital and test it. Then do the right thing, as the physician tell.
And Ms. Saujanya M., hello, sir. SARS has come and it disappeared mysteriously without any vaccine. I think the question is like, will the COVID go like that?
No, I don't think so. SARS has not disappeared. SARS was not transmitted so fast. So it was controlled and it was only in a pocket. So the pandemic not happened. And it was in 2008. Think about 2020 now. So people are traveling more rapidly. And SARS also was started in China, right? But that time the pandemic didn't happen, it was not traveled so far. So because of this nature of this virus, it is more infectious, more transmission rate is very high, and it can survive in temperatures for a long time, and it can transmit through air droplets. All these factors are causing this SARS coronavirus not to disappear very, very soon. It will be staying with us for some time till the vaccine comes. But you never know. It may mutate. It may come with another strain. We never know. So that's why virologists always look for things, pattern are changing, or things are happening. So the genotype, which virus we collect, we have a repository. We sequence them. We see how the virus is replicating. What's the changing genotype? So all these things are happening on the backside.
So I think partly you have answered this question. This is from Amulya Grida Sappa. Sir, do you believe in herbal treatment? There are few herbal formulations which are proven to be effective, even though they haven't got permission from ICMR.
I think I saw the news. I think one of the Patanjali product he was talking about, maybe. I'm not sure. I told you, I'm not an expert on the herbal medicine approach, but I had tested, or I had done some little bit research on curcumin, like the product of haldi, like we use in our curry. That curcumin has encapsulated in a nanoparticle. I had done that research to kill some cancer cells. So there are some effect of herbal products, but this virus, we have to kill it. Directly antiviral we need, or we have to block it. Somehow antibody response has to be there. Immune system will be boosted up, but the specific immune response has to be there regarding this virus. Only specific immune response or specific antibody to recognize this virus has to be developed. So that then only we can kill the virus. Otherwise, just boosting up our immune system will not help. Yeah, boosting up our immune, get vaccine. Our immune system is the vaccine.
Sorry to interrupt, sir. Your voice is
better, and we have a better immune system. Okay. I think there is some internet problem.
Yes, sir. Sir, one more question from
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Now it is clear, sir. Question from Ms. Kasala Priyanka. Sir, we will give vaccine to prevent infectious disease. If we get any of the infectious disease and we get cured without any medicine or vaccine, then what may be the chance of infecting with that virus again?
I think the question is towards this coronavirus may come back again or not, right? If you are vaccinated, if the strain is not changed, then the vaccine will work. But the vaccine immune response is how long, we have to see that. Once we give the vaccine, then only we know, okay, yearly we have to give a vaccine, or we have to give a booster dose to immune response boost up for a couple of years, like the flu vaccine. People are taking every year, like seasonal. So the seasonality of this virus may come back, you know, in the winter season again, it may come back. So if a good vaccine is there, good immune response is there, it may protect us. So depends on, this virus is very new. We are learning every time, every day, learning new things about it, and still a lot of things to be known. So wait for the research to come up, and more studies needed.
And same participant, sir, she want confirmation whether it is airborne. We are hearing that it is airborne. So is it true?
Yes, it is. It is airborne.
And we have one final question, sir. This coronavirus, this is from B. Surya Priya. Sir, is this coronavirus a mutating one? If so, how can vaccines work against this?
Oh, good question. It is mutating, not that fast rate as other viruses, right? Like hepatitis C virus, there is no vaccine because it's mutated so fast. There is some other viruses, they mutate very fast. But this is good that the spike protein is not changing a lot. The spike protein, which most of the vaccines are designing, that is not changing. So vaccine will work. It is not mutating that fast. So if it is, if we are not exposed to another animal source or a wild animal source, it came up another virus, it will not, we will be very rarely, we'll get it again, like another kind of coronavirus, very rarely.
With this, we come to the end of the questions posted by the participants here. I request Mr. Shankar from Haxbio Health Services to tell his vote of thanks for the session.
Hello.
Hi.
Thank you, Dr. Sir. Yeah, thank you, sir. And Finally, I would like to take this opportunity to place our hearty thanks to our beloved speaker, Dr. Siddhartha Hazari, for his excellent and informative speech on the topic of COVID-19 strategies and challenges faced by pharma professionals in terms of formulating a vaccine. Chapter 1, COVID-19, Vaccine Development and Challenges. Thank you, sir. Thank you for taking your time and giving a valuable speech to all of us. Also, I must mention our deep sense of appreciation to Dr. B.A. Vishwanath, Chairman, Aditi and Solutions, Bangalore. I also wish to express my gratitude to Indian Pharmaceutical Association for associating with us in this series of webinars. I'm also very grateful to congratulate the team of Aditya, Mrs. Suchitra and Dr. K. Nagasri, and the team of Axio, Mr. Srinivasan, Mr. Ilavarsu, and Mr. Arun. In this such a short time, you have made the best arrangement for this webinar program. Thank you, Mrs. Suchitra and Dr. Nagasri. I have also obliged to the participants present here. Your participation and suggestions always help us. Finally, I would like to say this to cell pass. Stay safe and stay healthy. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, dear participants, before we wind up, there is a link for the feedback shared with you in the chat group. And this room is full and we have shared it on the live stream also.
Hello.
Please kindly fill in.
Sarji.
So that you'll be receiving your certificate to the registered mail ID. Please give in the name which you want it as in the certificate. So with this, we would wind it up. I thank all the Haxwell Health Services, our speaker Siddharth Hazari, sir, and the group team, Aditya Institutions, our beloved chairman, sir, for giving us the opportunity to learn and gain through this pandemic time. Thank you so much, dear participants, for staying with us. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir, can I wind it up?
Yes.
Thank you, sir.